Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjaleyammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Kovilvanni. I am happy to meet you again through the video lecture on the subject steam boiler. And this is lecture number 2 on the steam boilers. And we recap from the previous lecture. So in the previous lecture, we defined what is a boiler and we classified the boiler. And we discussed the working of different boilers like a simple vertical boiler, coke current boiler, Lancashire boiler, locomotive boiler and Babcock Wilcox boiler. So here the first 2-4, simple vertical boiler, coke current boiler, Lancashire boiler and locomotive boiler, they are fire tube boilers, and Babcock Wilcox boiler is a water tube boiler. And we continue with the construction and working of the boiler, and we compare the fire tube water tube boiler in the towards the end of the lecture. And this is the next two boilers, Stirling boiler, so which is also a water tube boiler. So it is called as multi drum bent tube boiler. So the pressure, maximum pressure is 60 bar and the temperature is around 450 degrees Celsius, and the capacity of the boiler is 50,000 kilograms per hour. So it can produce 50,000 kilograms per hour of the steam in the boiler. So look at the construction. You take a few seconds, look at the construction. We have number of drum. So 1, 2, 3, they are the drum. 6 is also the drum. So 1, 2, 3, they are the water drum, and the water drum, they are connected by tubes, number of bent tubes. And at the bottom, 6 is called as mud drum, and the number of tubes are connected between the mud drum and the steam drums. And we have the baffle plates, number 7 baffle plate, number 8 is the superheater. We have the bundle of superheater, and we have the fire grate, number 9 fire grate, where the burning of the fuel is taking place. And number 4 is equalizing tubes. So equalizing tubes means in all the 3 drums we have to maintain the same level of water and the steam. So to equalize the level of steam and the water, so we are connecting the 3 drums. So there is one advantage of the bent tube. So because of heating, the tube material will expand. Because of the bend of the tube, so the expansion will be accommodated easily. So the overall structural problem will not occur in the case of Stirling boiler. So it is a high pressure boiler, so where the burning of the fuel is taking place on the grate. So here again we supply coal to the grate, the combustion is taking place, the ash is collected at the bottom below the grate, and the air is flowing in the upper direction. So using the air, the fuel is burning, hot gases are produced, and the hot gases are flowing across the tube and the drum. So we have, look at the diagram, we have the number 7 baffle plates. So look at the arrowhead. So there are arrow lines, lines with the arrowhead. So that indicates the direction of the flow of flue gases. So first the flue gases, they are moving vertically in the upward direction. It is heating the tubes. It is heating the 5 water tubes and the superheater. Then it take a turn. So this is what turning of the flue gases, and when the flue gases, they are flowing here, so it is heating the drum also, the 3 drum also, then it is taking turn and it is flowing downward. So here there are bundle of tubes, so some of the tube contain water, some tubes may be contain steam. So it is heating the water and the steam, and then it is again taking a turn at the bottom and flowing over the other drum, other part of the boiler, and leaving to the atmosphere through the small opening at the left side. So as the flow, as the flue gases are flowing in different up and down, so the heat is utilized effectively by the tubes and the drum. So maximum amount of heat will be extracted from the flue gases for the conversion of water into steam and for superheating the steam. So this is Stirling boiler. It is also called as multi drum boiler, and it has a capacity of 50,000 kilograms per hour. And the specifications are maximum pressure is 60 bar and temperature is 40 degree Celsius. And next type of boiler is law mount boiler. So it is high pressure boiler. High pressure water tube boiler. So here the maximum pressure is 130 bar and the temperature is 500 degrees Celsius. The capacity is around 50 tons. You take few seconds and look at the construction of the law mount boiler. So the various parts of the boiler, they are starting from the bottom. We have a vertical shell. We have a vertical boiler shell and we have the grate, and below the grate we have the ash pit. So in the grate, the fire, the burning of the fuel is taking place. So through the small opening on the right hand side, we are supplying the fuel to the grate and the hot gases are produced here. These hot gases, they are flowing in the upward direction. So, as the hot gas are flowing in the upward direction, first they are heating the evaporator. So, evaporator and then superheater, economizer, air preheater, and then it leaves to the atmosphere. All these components are shown by line that indicates it is tube bundle. So, number of horizontal tubes are arranged. They are arranged in such a way that the hot gases are flowing between the tubes to heat the water, to heat the steam, and to heat the incoming air. So as the water is, as the gas is flowing in the upward direction, first the evaporator is absorbing the heat energy. So evaporator is the device which is converting water into steam. Then it goes to the superheater where the steam is superheated. So using the heat energy, we are superheating the steam. Then it goes to the economizer where the heat is utilized for heating the incoming water. So economizer is used for heating incoming water. Then the gases are flowing across the air preheater where the air required for combustion, they are flowing through the air preheater. So the combustion gases, the hot gases are heating the air. Then after that, the waste gases are leaving to the atmosphere. So the burning of the fuel is taking place. Hot gases are formed. They are flowing vertically in the upward direction. It is crossing various devices. Now looking at the drum, on the left side we have the water feed water tank. So through the feed water tank we are supplying the water, so using the feed pump. So using the feed pump, so pressurized water is supplied. So first it is flowing through the economizer. So economizer, it is utilizing the waste heat of the flue gases. Suppose there is no economizer, so the water will be admitted at room temperature. Now using the waste heat, In the economizer, the water is heated. So, the water will be entering the steam separated drum with a higher temperature. So, the amount of heat required in the evaporator or in the combustion chamber will be reduced. So, economizer is an accessory which is installed to improve the efficiency of the boiler plant. Economizer. Then, we have the steam separating drum. So, here the water is entering and the water from here. So, from water from here, it is taken to the circulating pump and then distribution header. So, from here, the water is circulated through the evaporator. So, water is taken to the circulating, by the circulating pump, and it is circulated through the evaporator where the water absorbs the heat energy, converted into steam, and the steam is returning to the drum once again. So, the steam separating drum. So, here the at the top of the drum, we have the steam. Now, the steam, when you open the steam stop valve, so the steam from here, so it flows through the superheater and then it is superheated. So, superheated steam will go to the steam turbine or the steam engine. Then, the air is entering, atmospheric air is entering using a blower. So, air is also circulated with the help of a blower. So, the force, the air, it flows to the air preheater. So, the air in the air preheater, the air absorbs the heat energy of the waste gases. So, using that, the air temperature is reduced. So, when the hot air is supplied to the combustion chamber, so the combustion efficiency will be better and it will give complete combustion of the fuel and more heat will be produced with less quantity of fuel. So, the using the, actually the air preheater is also an accessory which is installed to improve the efficiency of the boiler plant. So, here we have three accessories. One is superheater, economizer, air purifier. So feed pump is also an accessory. It is used to improve the to provide the forced circulation of water, which will improve the efficiency of the boiler. So the long mount boiler is a high pressure boiler which is operating at 130 bar with a temperature of 500 degrees Celsius. The capacity is 50 tons per hour, and it is a water tube high pressure boiler. Next is low flow boiler. So it is also water tube boiler with this higher capacity, 1 lakh kilograms per hour with a pressure of 150 bar. Now you take few seconds and look at the construction of the low flow boiler. So in the low flow boiler, so if you look at here, so the combustion furnace is here on the side, the fuel is supplied, maybe coal or the oil is supplied here. The combustion of the fuel is taking place in the furnace, and the hot gases are produced. So the hot gases, first they are flowing through the radiant superheater. So the in the furnace zone, we have the radiant superheater. The radiant superheater absorbs the heat energy, then the hot gases are flowing downward and it take a turn. So when it is flowing in the upward direction, first it is heating the convection superheater, economizer. Convection superheater, economizer, air preheater, and it is leaving to the atmosphere. So here we do not have the evaporator coil. So we have the economizer, and the water is, the hot water is taken to the drum here. We have a steam evaporating drum. So here we have the evaporating drum. So in the evaporating drum, we have the water and the steam, and the heating of the water is also taking place by mixing with the steam. So you look at here. So here the steam is taken, some quantity of steam is taken and admitted back to the boiler drum, evaporating drum. So using the steam heat, the water is further heated. Now from here, the steam from here, from the top of the drum, the steam is taken to the first the radiant superheater. So look at here. So it is flowing through the steam circulating pump, and you have a line. So here it is radiant superheater, then the convection superheater, then it is leaving to the steam turbine. So water is entering from the feed tank, water is entering circulated by the feed pump. It is flowing through the economizer, where it absorbs the heat energy from the flue gases, hot gases, and converted high temperature water is produced, and the water is taken to the evaporating drum. So in the evaporating drum, we are mixing certain quantity of steam, and this water is heated and converted into steam, and the steam is taken to the superheater, radiant superheater, then convection superheater, and then taken to the steam turbine. So here in between, to pressurize the steam, to circulate the steam, we have a steam circulating pump. And the air from the atmosphere, it is taken by the air blower and circulated to the air preheater. So air preheater absorbs the heat energy of the flue gases, and if the air is heated, the hot air is supplied to the furnace for the combustion of the fuel. So here again, we have the water drum, separating drum at the bottom. We have the four important accessories: the feed pump, air preheater, economizer, and the superheater. Normally in the high pressure boiler, we have two types of superheater. One is radiant superheater, another one is convection superheater. The radiant superheater is installed in the radiant zone near the combustion chamber. The convection superheater, it is away from the combustion chamber. So it is absorbing the heat energy by convection mode. The radiant superheater is absorbing the heat energy, maximum amount of heat energy, by the radiation mode. So this is working, radiant superheater is working on the radiation mode, convection superheater is working on the convection mode. That is why we have radiant superheater and convection superheater. Economizer and air preheater, they are also absorbing the heat energy by means of convection mode of heat transfer. So this is low flow boiler, which is a capacity of 1 lakh kilograms per hour of steam. It can produce steam at the rate of 1 lakh kilograms per hour. Operating pressure is around maximum of 150 bar. It is water tube boiler, high pressure boiler. Next boiler is Benson boiler. So look at the diagram for a few seconds. So here also we have a boiler vertical shell and various components are available here. So the combustion system, ash pit, the grate and the fire, combustion of the fuel is taking place on the grate. The fuel is applied here and we have first radiant evaporator and then convection superheater, convection evaporator, then we have the economizer, air preheater. So the hot gases are formed by burning the coal. So coal is applied from here, hot air is applied by the air preheater. So the combustion of the fuel is taking place in the combustion chamber or the top of the grate. The hot gases are formed. The hot gases are flowing in the upward direction. So first it is flowing across the radiant evaporator, then superheater, convection superheater, then convection evaporator and the economizer, air preheater, then it leaves to the atmosphere. Now we look at the circulation of water. So using the feed water tank and using the feed pump, the water is circulated first through the economizer. So economizer, the water is heated using the flue gases. So the temperature of the water is increased. Then the water, it is flowing through the radiant evaporator. So radiant evaporator means the evaporator is installed in the combustion chamber, near the combustion chamber, radiant zone. And it absorbs maximum amount of heat energy and converted into steam. So the evaporation of the water is taking place in the radiant evaporator. Then from the radiant evaporator, the water is going to the convection evaporator. So further, if you have small particles of water particles in the steam, it is further heated up and converted into superheated steam. That is what the convection evaporator. Then it is flowing through the superheater, where the steam is superheated to a higher temperature, and the superheated steam, it is going to the steam turbine through the steam stop valve. And the air is entering here, cold air from the atmosphere is entering here and it is taken by the blower, and using the blower, the air is circulated through the air preheater, where the air is absorbing the heat energy from the flue gases and the hot air is supplied to the combustion chamber. So if you look at here, in the Benson boiler, there is no steam separating drum. In the case of Lamont boiler and the low flow boiler, we find a drum for collecting the steam and the water and separating steam from the water. But here there is no steam separating drum, and this is called as once through boiler. So what is once through boiler? The water is entering and flowing through various devices, for example economizer, radiant evaporator, convective evaporator and superheater, then it is converted as a steam. So enters as water and flows through various tubes and converted into steam and leaving as a steam. This is called as once through boiler, and this is also a supercritical boiler. So what is supercritical boiler? When the pressure of the steam is higher than 221 bar, then it is called as supercritical boiler. And normally for higher capacity, very high capacity of the steam generation, we are using the Benson boiler or supercritical boiler. So pressure is around 500 bar, the temperature is 650 degrees Celsius, and the capacity of the Benson boiler is, so it can produce 1.5 lakhs of steam per hour. 1.5 lakhs kilograms of steam per hour. So this is the Benson boiler, which is one through boiler, supercritical boiler. And what is supercritical boiler? So depending on the operation, depending on the boiler pressure, we can classify into subcritical and the supercritical boiler. So subcritical boiler, the pressure will be around 125 bar and temperature is 510 degrees Celsius. For supercritical boiler, the pressure is above 300 bar and temperature is 660 degrees Celsius. The supercritical boiler require only economizer and the superheater. There is no evaporator. So we have number of tubes, so through which the water is heated up and converted into steam. The advantages of supercritical boiler are large heat transfer rate, higher thermal efficiency, more adaptable for load fluctuation, erosion and corrosion problems are minimized. So normally we use very highly purified water for supercritical boiler, so the erosion corrosion problems are minimized. There is no accumulation of water in a drum, so that there is no problem of erosion and corrosion. So it can easily adapt to the load fluctuation. When you want to more amount of steam, simply we have to regulate the quantity of water. We have to supply more quantity of water. So large heat transfer rate, large heat transfer area is available. So you can easily produce, quickly produce a large quantity of steam in the case of supercritical boiler. And the advantages of high pressure boiler. So the earlier boiler, Cochran boiler, Lancashire boiler, or locomotive boiler, they are all low pressure boiler. High pressure boiler are Babcock Wilcox boiler, Stirling boiler, and Lamont boiler, Loeffler boiler. They are the high pressure boiler, and we have the supercritical boiler like Benson boiler. So if you look at the high pressure boiler, we have the important devices like blower for circulating the air, and feed pump for circulating the water. We have the air preheater, we have the economizer, we have the different types of superheater. So there are specific advantages of high pressure boiler. So first advantage is forced circulation of water is used, which increases the evaporation capacity and less number of drum. So by using a pressurized system of pressurized circulation of water, we can circulate more quantity of water and produce more quantity of steam. And the pressurized combustion increases the rate of combustion and combustion efficiency. So what is pressurized combustion? We are circulating air using a blower. So using the forced draught system, we are supplying the hot air, so which will improve the combustion and combustion efficiency. So due to compactness, lesser floor area is required. So overall size, because of we are using many tubes, so there is no huge drum like your Babcock Wilcox boiler or the locomotive boiler. So we are using a compact tube arrangement, which require lesser floor area. And the scale formation is eliminated due to the forced circulation of water. So the water is flowing with a higher speed, so the scale formation on the heat transfer path is minimized. The heat transfer surface area is increased because of large number of tubes of lesser diameter. So heat transfer area is increasing. So the amount of heat transfer will increase because of the area, and the more amount of heat transfer to the water to convert into steam. And the steam will be produced quickly, and the efficiency of the boiler is high. So in the high pressure boiler, the efficiency will be high. And the use of high pressure and high temperature steam is economical, because we require only lesser quantity of steam for producing the power. So it is economical, highly efficient, and it has many advantages, high pressure boiler. And the merits and demerits of fire tube boiler. So we studied the fire tube boiler earlier, and what are all the advantages and the disadvantages of the fire tube boiler. Fire tube boiler, so like your Cochran boiler, locomotive boiler, or Lancashire boiler, the merits are simple and rigid construction, more reliable, quickly respond to the change in the load, compact, and the space occupied per kg of the steam is less. So the space requirement per kg of steam is less, and the initial cost of the fire tube boiler is low. And the demerits are slow in reaching the operating pressure. So because it has to pick up, so it has slowly heating the water. So because the water is stored in a large drum, all the water is to be heated. So the operation will take more time. Large diameter shell is required for storing the water. Maximum steam generation capacity is 9000 kilograms per hour. So maximum is 9000 or 10000 kilograms per hour. Transportation is inconvenient because it is assembled and transported. So we have to completely assemble the boiler in the boiler production plant, and then we have to transport. So it is very difficult for transport the boiler. Low rate of steam generation makes it unsuitable for steam power plant. Normally the fire tube boiler, they are used for industrial process, not for the power generation. So small industry, for example a sugar mill, a paper mill, so we require the chemical plant where we require the steam, hotel, we require the steam for cooking purpose. So for these kind of industrial operations, we can use the fire tube boiler. And merits and demerits of water tube boiler. The advantage of the water tube boiler, the steam generation is quicker and steam pressure is as high as 200 bar. So, we can go up to 200 bar pressure. Whereas, in the case of a fire tube boiler, we can restrict up to 80 bar. So, the combustion efficiency is higher comparing with the fire tube boiler. The boiler can be easily transported and erected as its parts can be separated. So, here normally water tube boiler, we make the part, boiler part, and take all the part to the boiler site and we assemble the boiler component in the boiler site. So, they are called as site assembled boiler. Water tube boiler normally, they are site assembled. Whereas, fire tube boiler, they are assembled, factory assembled and then transported. So, individual water tubes can be replaced. Suppose there is a problem with the water tube, that tube alone can be replaced. All parts of water tube boiler are easily accessible for cleaning, inspecting and repairing. So, we have the design like that. All the tubes are easily accessible for cleaning, inspection and repairing. And demerits of the water tube boiler. Water tube boiler are less suitable for impure water because the water is flowing through the pipeline. Suppose you have impure water, there will be scale formation in the tube which will reduce the circulation of water and the efficiency of the boiler plant. So, sometimes it will lead to the bursting of the tube. So, pure feed water is required in the case of water tube boiler. The maintenance cost is higher comparing with the water tube, the fire tube boiler. Failure in feed water supply result in overheating and the tube bursting. So, failure in feed water supply. Suppose there is a failure in the water supply that will lead to overheating and the tube bursting. These are all the demerits of the water tube boiler. And when you install a boiler, so there are some requirements. So, what are the requirements of a good boiler? A good boiler must possess the following qualities. The boiler should be capable to generate steam at the required pressure and quantity as quickly as possible with minimum fuel consumption. So, the fuel consumption should be lower. And the boiler should produce the steam required quantity at a given pressure and at a given pressure as quick as possible. Initial cost, installation cost and maintenance cost should be low. The boiler should be light in weight and should occupy smaller floor area. The boiler must meet the fluctuation in the load demand. What is load demand? Required by the industry. Suppose many industries are working, so we require more amount of electricity to generate. Suppose the night time, many industry they will shut down, now the current requirement will be less. So, that is what the fluctuation in the electrical power. So, according to the fluctuation of the electrical power, so we have to produce the steam. So, the boiler should respond to the fluctuation in the load. The cleaning and the inspection of the boiler should be easy. So, we have to have the access to the boiler through the manhole or the smoke door. Through the various openings, we have to, a man should enter into the boiler for inspection and repair. The boiler erection time should be minimum. So, complete installation time should be minimum. There should not be mud deposition on the heat transfer area and soot deposition on the boiler part. So, mud deposition on the water flow area and soot deposition on the gas flow area. On the outside of the economizer, outside of the superheater, outside of the air preheater, there should not be any soot deposition, that is dust deposition. In the flue gas, we have the dust particle, and the dust particle, they are called as soot. They should not deposit. That means the gas should be pure. The number of amount of dust available, amount of soot available should be low. And similarly, the amount of scale deposition on the heat transfer area should be low. And for that, we require pure air and pure water. The boiler should conform to the safety regulations as per the Boiler Act. So, Indian Boiler Regulation, they are giving some norms for operating, installing and operating the boiler. So, we have to design, install and operate as per the Indian Boiler Act. We stop here. So, these are all the books I published earlier in the mechanical engineering subject. Design of transmission system, turbo machines, heat and mass transfer, operations research, gas dynamics and jet propulsion, thermal engineering, fluid mechanics and machinery. And also I have a YouTube channel where I upload the video lectures on all the subjects mentioned here. So, you can use the video lectures for your better learning. And also I am uploading the solution for the gate question paper in mechanical engineering subject. You can use it to make a pass in the gate examination. So you subscribe the channel and learn all the mechanical engineering subject through the video lecturing. So thank you for watching. So please post your comments. If you have any comments, post your comments on the YouTube comments box. You can contact me through my mail ID or WhatsApp number for any clarification. So thank you once again. We'll meet again with another topic in the next video lecture.